Good afternoon and welcome to the EY degree conferring ceremony. You have found on your chairs headsets. This is not for translation, but to hear better in case you cannot hear very well. I would like to invite the president of the EY, Professor Joseph Weiler, for his welcome address.
President of the High Council and members of the High Council, my colleagues, our guests, and in particular the families, parents, brothers, sisters, sons and daughters of newly minted doctorates and LLMs, and finally, of course, you at the center, people who will be receiving your degrees very shortly. Welcome to all of you. I want to first address the families. I address you first because it's a special day for me as well. One of my sons is graduating today at Stanford University, so I have great sympathy and empathy and can actually live the feelings that you are living today, seeing your dear ones graduating. I hope he forgives me for being here and not there. But it is a very special day, a very moving moment to see your children's or brothers or sisters or fathers or mothers taking this tremendously important passage in life, receiving a master's or a doctorate with a full and promising life ahead of them. I want to thank the members of the High Council for being with us today. It's our institution. You are part of it, and it's important that you're at the ceremony today and participate and are part in this really defining event, an event that defines our most important mission. I want to thank my colleagues. Some might get the impression that being a professor at the European University Institute is a lighter task than being a professor anywhere else. Nothing could be further from the truth. It's a life dedicated to research, and as part of that research, this most important task of supervising and guiding a new generation of researchers, scholars, and professionals. It's a rewarding life. If somebody comes here for 8 years, a good productive professor in a period of 8 years might write 2, maybe 3 books. But when all your students are doctoral students, in a period of 8 years you might write 1 or 2 books, but really 15 or 16 or 17 other books will be written by your doctoral students. And there's nothing that can be more rewarding to a researcher and a teacher to see that type of accomplishment. I turn last to all of you. So you know that I meant to say some pompous things about... So the first thing is, if we are to judge from the past, and that's the only way we can judge, you will be having spectacular careers. 70% of you will be university professors, and 30% will hold positions of responsibility in public life, in the professions, in industry. And I suppose that in these days and times that's something important to think about. What will life deal me? And you should be expecting that kind of rewarding life. But there are two other things that I want you to be taking with you when you leave us, and we will miss you. One is that it's not only about the training and the professional lives you will be leading, but it's a memory of a commitment to the world of the mind, to the world of ideas, to serious and deep thinking about problems and issues and concepts and values. It's not something to leave behind when you move on to the next step of your life, the next stage of your life. And the second thing is to remind you that beyond one's job and one's career, you are custodians. You are custodians in each of your fields of a great civilization, a great tradition of learning, of concepts, and of values. And custodianship means a responsibility, not only towards yourselves, but also towards the society in which you will be living. So on behalf of all of us, I want to congratulate all of you on this important day. And thank you, ladies and gentlemen. We are now going to move on to the actual ceremony. Thank you. So first, I will invite the president of the High Council of the European University Institute, Jorge Sainz González.
Okay, I will be brief, not that brief, as Salvador Dalí said once, you know, thank you for inviting me, goodbye. I will be not that brief. I just want to first to congratulate the two honorary doctors that they are receiving their degree and they are becoming part of this European University Institute family today. Especially, I would like to congratulate all the graduates, but those to both sides of me. But I want to congratulate especially their families. They know how hard this has been, and they know how difficult the good times, but especially the bad times, they have been through it. So I want to congratulate the families. I want to congratulate their academic families, your program peers, your professors, the non-academic staff on the departments. They have been also through that trip with you, and I think that relations are forever. I want to congratulate also the staff at the European University Institute. They have helped you reach this level, and they will help you in the future. And now is your time. Go outside and make us proud of what you have done, what you have learned. And for now, when you think about this time, think about the European Union and how much they have helped you to reach this finish. Good luck.
Today, we award two doctorates honoris causa, and I would like to call the honorary promoter, Professor Grundmann, to address the first honorary doctor, Professor Lubowolf.
Ms. Lubowolf, Mr. President, ladies and gentlemen, when I became a young professor in 1994, Ms. Lubowolf, Gertrud Lubowolf, was already a star. Let me specify, a quiet and intensive star, not known to all, but all the more shining and impressive to those who share these three convictions. First, legal scholarship is ultimately social sciences from a particular perspective, the ordering power of the legal regime, yet a scholarship which, in its ultimate justification, always needs to be grounded in the knowledge of what all social sciences think about the problems of society and its order. Ms. Lubowolf is a legal philosopher. We will come back on her contributions on Hegel. In her family, she is surrounded by philosophers, herself a legal philosopher, but her writings are just as much writings informed in political and social theory of political philosophy. Second, legal scholarship, namely in Europe, cannot be but national and supra or transnational. Ms. Lubowolf was a judge at the German Constitutional Court over the last 12 years, 2002 to 2014. and not only had to decide on core questions of the relationship between the national and the supra or international, down to famous OMT, but during that time she also spoke out loud in the legal scholarship discourse on such core concepts of the supranational as homogeneity, what is its value for a committee or others. She's always profound not only in the international setting, but goes deep into the national details, and conversely, she is always intense not only in the national concreteness, but sees at the same time the broader transnational picture. And third conviction, when grounded in theory, social theory and political philosophy, as it should be, legal scholarship should not be theory only, which is already valuable. It should be more valuable still, theory which matters in concrete life, in concrete facts. Let me just give one example of one of her opinions at the Constitutional Court. German law required 3 months of domicile for giving the right to vote also to Germans living abroad. Formally, 3 months within the last 2 years, with new legislation, 3 months at any time. The amendment was attacked as being arbitrary, and Ms. Wolf, opined like this. While formally information and communication was the key for a committee for giving that right to vote, and then, of course, new information needed to be solid and recent. With new information technologies, this has changed. You can inform yourself as well abroad. And therefore, the core factor becomes the attachment, the responsibility via attachment. And who has lived for 3 months in Germany has shown that he has this attachment. Changed information technology or technology, eternal concepts of attachment to a certain committee. We will have a Nobel Prize laureate in economics as the second new Dr. honoris causa. Therefore, in parallel to the most famous equilibrium in economics, the Nash equilibrium in game theory, I would call this double combination of the national and the international, and of theory down in concrete facts, the double Liebewolf equilibrium. So embeddedness in social sciences and political philosophy, equilibrium in the, of the national and the international sphere, and applied theory to concrete problems of our times. These three philosophies made me say, when I became a young professor, she was already a intensive, quiet, shining star like very few others, because she combined these three philosophies from the beginning. First, with her PhD doctorate from 1980, which was grounded in Wittgensteinian love for clear terminology and language, but then combined with a clear consequentialist perception as well, combining thus epistemology with teleology, logic with facts of life. Asking for this combination also for our high-ranked judges and decision takers in the realm of law. She distinguishes between the direct effects of adjudication, which judges typically care for, and indirect effects of adjudication for the whole of the society, which she sees even Supreme Court judges tend to know too little about and neglect too often. And typical for her writings, the examples for this are manifold. The theory derived from that, the theories are very few and very clear ones. Then second, with her habilitation thesis of 1988, overcoming the old dichotomy of application of fundamental rights. On the one hand, fundamental rights as applied to acts encroaching on the freedom of the people, and on the other hand, fundamental rights as applied to so-called benefit administration when the state gives you. Pleading for a common standard for both areas and influencing heavily the Constitutional Court's case law later on with that. For reasons of time and because I'm not a constitutional lawyer who could duly do justice to this opus magnum, I do not go into more details, but just say that it is this work which many believe has earned her very early her appointment to the German Constitutional Court in 2002. As successor to Jutta Limbach, the first woman ever at this court. Then third, in 1996, which I know best, Ms. Lubbe-Wolf not only is a brilliant constitutional lawyer, but she loves being concrete, down to real life, and she wrote a masterpiece of administrative law as well. Highly influential, her comprehensive report to the Parliamentary Enquete Commission on the German environmental law. Combining combats with incentives, combining perceptions of rules with those of institutions, and helping really profoundly to reshape modern German environmental law. This made her a genuinely public figure and person in many disciplines. And as Elmau and G7 showed again, this is a very German concern and area of the law. 8 years between each of these works, 1980, 88, 96, milestones of her scholarly development and perhaps even of Germany's legal scholarship development. 8 years later, she sat on the German Constitutional Court. This is somehow 8 years the time as well to create a big family, in my feeling. In my feeling, Ms. Lubbe-Wolf is so concrete and so profound because in her quiet and intensive way, she just loves life in all its profoundness. And gave also birth to 4 children. Let me end with Hegel and with the little bit of personal relationship I have with Ms. Lubbe-Wolf. When very recently she wrote about Hegel, whose appeal has diminished after World War II in Germany, her approach was not German in style at all, to oppose one approach which mainly stresses the importance of morals, also in economics, also in politics, and one approach which carefully designs institutions for real man, as it is, and pleading more for the second, or forcefully for the second, and the little bit of personal relationship. Well, in 1999 or 98, highly impressed by the report to the Parliamentary Enquete Commission on Environmental Law, I approached her and I asked her whether she wanted to write in a series of textbooks on European law, which I was putting up to write on European environmental law. She accepted. She contributed in conceiving the series along the lines of these three philosophies I have spoken about, but then withdrew to become later a judge at the German Constitutional Court. I understood that, of course. She has written there a certain number of dissenting opinions, around 10 cases where she could not convince her colleagues, and I read them. When proposed to this doctorate honoris causa of the European Institute, she replied with joy, but with the proviso that she would decline the honor if it was awarded mainly for those dissents. And the reason she gave, perhaps I should not even have disclosed this detail, but the reason she gave was this one. The right of German Constitutional Court justices, which for instance, Constitutional Court justices in neighboring France do still not have, the right to dissent is so precious for her, for the mechanism of the court's finding, that she wouldn't like to put it in danger, even by receiving an honor just because of dissents. I find this standard of honor applied in this reaction, the standard of personal morals, such that if it was general, Ms. Lübbe-Wolf would belie herself. We would need just morals and no institutions for men. For her outstanding scientific oeuvre and the philosophy and morals on which it is based, I present Gertrude Lübbe-Wolf for admission to the honorary degree of Doctor of the European University Institute. And I invite her to take the floor.
Thank you, dear Stefan Grundmann, for these very nice and appreciative words, and thank you to those who are responsible for my being here today. I've given a lecture this morning, so no more words about law now, just a few personal remarks. After 12 years on the court, when I was released last June, and since then, I have felt like Sisyphus redeemed, and today I feel even better than that. This may be perhaps, or one of the reasons may be that I'm not a mathematician or a natural scientist. If Adam Smith is to be trusted on that matter, natural scientists and mathematicians are very amiable people, never scheming, never plotting for their own reputation, because they can be so sure about the merits of what they have done. And according to Smith, the other, the non-scientific culture people, scientific in the narrow Snowian sense, are quite different. They do plot for their reputation, and they do scheme to hold the reputation of their colleagues down so that they may themselves shine brighter. And they tend to be overjoyed by public applause because, well, since their fields, in their fields of work, there is their work isn't so susceptible to proof, they are much more dependent on other people's applause, also on honor, and therefore they tend to be more than ordinarily elevated when they get some sort of positive feedback and applause. Well, I must say I do feel more than ordinarily elevated today, although I hope it's not mainly for the reason given by Adam Smith. I might even be a little taken aback by Adam Smith's observations, because they remind me that even with respect to an honorary degree, I'm much worse off than a mathematician or a natural scientist, because it cannot be proved that I deserve it. But I won't let that thought depress me. I will just say, I'm very grateful to be here. It's wonderful to be a, well, honorary doctor in spe, still of EUI. EUI to me represents much of what is attractive about Europe and the European Union. It brings people from all over Europe and beyond together in a spirit of cooperation and endeavor. It does so in a place, in one of the most beautiful places of Europe, replete with history and human achievement. So I feel I have a sense of great privilege about becoming somehow associated with this institution, and that also reminds me that I'm lucky, and that not everybody in Europe, let alone in the world at large, is as favorably affected by Europeanization and globalization as I am, and probably most of us in this place are. So it also reinforces my conviction that work has to be done to prevent the gap between winners and losers of these processes from widening. It's a great event for me. Thank you.
On behalf of the university, I admit you to the honorary degree of Doctor of the European University Institute.
I would now like to invite promoter Professor David Levine to address the honorary doctor to Professor Jean Tirole.
So this is my second attempt to introduce my classmate, my co-author, and my friend Jean Tirole, and I hope to make a better job of it this time than I did the first. It is said that a generalist knows nothing about everything, and that a specialist knows everything about nothing. Less often said, but equally true, is that the prolific is the antithesis of the Nobel Prize. Prolific is to the Nobel Prize as generalist is to specialist. John Nash is the epitome of the Nobel Prize winner in economics. He had a long and unproductive life, except for a single deeply significant insight early in his career. So what should we make of Jean Tirole? Unfortunately, he does not number the papers in his vita, so I had to count them by hand. My own rough count is that over a career of 34 years, he's published about 175 papers in scientific journals. It's about 5 papers a year. He's very prolific indeed. Jean has written about speculation and bargaining. He's written about patents and puppy dogs, about innovation and hierarchies, about procurement and collusion, about sunspots and contracts, about self-control and the environment. I'm afraid more than I have time to say in 10 minutes. Jean received his non-honorary doctorate in 1981 from MIT. At that time, the use of game theoretic tools to understand information uncertainty was beginning to revolutionize economics, and the concepts of mechanism design and incentive constraints were being developed. I hope that this sounds very abstract to you, because economics is a very practical and applied science, and the importance of those abstract tools is in the light they shed on important and practical problems. Why is the banking system here in the EU in such awful shape, for example? It is here that we have proof that breadth is not necessarily the enemy of depth, because Jean's work using the abstract tools of game theory and mechanism design to study the important and practical problems of government regulation in a modern mixed economy is deep indeed. In 1993, Jean's book with his lifelong collaborator, Jean-Jacques Lafont, A Theory of Incentives in Procurement and Regulation, was a revolutionary use of economic theory applied to a very important and practical problem. The book begins by re-examining the classical problem of price and rate of return regulation. Government-granted monopolies are generally limited in the prices that they can charge or the profits that they're allowed to earn. This can and does lead to malincentives, leading to underinvestment, low quality, and lack of effort. And I ask you whether you've ever tried to get internet service here in Italy, if you're wondering what that's about. To understand how the problem can be mitigated, it's necessary to understand both the uncertain and the temporal components of supply and demand. Lafon and Tyrol tackled these problems head on, and this book is the Bible for those who work in the area of regulation. Our own Jean-Michel Glanchon can speak to that. The book goes on to address key issues of competition policy and privatization. The latter is particularly topical. For example, in Greece, where privatization of the transport system is a bone of contention between the Greek government and its creditors. From Lafon to Roll, we know that the key trade-offs are three: the ability of government to get private firms to respond to changed circumstances, the limited incentives of managers under direct government control, and the tendency of government agencies to be captured by special interests. Now, there's a lot more in the book, including the tools for a proper cost-benefit analysis, but I think you'll have to read the book for that. Now, this is a pretty unusual introduction for me. Usually, I get to talk for 5 minutes, and a speaker gets to talk for an hour and a half. Today, I get to talk for 10 minutes, and the speaker only gets five. So let me speak briefly on Jean's behalf. Jean cares deeply about making the world a better place for people. Jean is French foremost, European second most, and a citizen of the world. If you read his papers, or if you attend his lectures, you'll find many equations and dry prose, and the depth of his care may not be apparent. But Jean trained as an engineer, and he's become an engineer of economics, an engineer of society. Just as the dry equations of the airplane engineer let us travel faster with greater safety and more comfort, so do each of Jean's equations help to make the world a better place for all of us to live in. Now, you might think that revolutionizing the theory of regulation and publishing 175 papers and 9 books on a diverse range of economic topics would be enough for one career. And if that was the case, you would not understand how bleak economics was in Europe 30 years ago. There were a few bright spots in the United Kingdom and actually right here at the EUI, but intellectually the center of the world was the United States, and within the United States, MIT. So you can imagine how shocked we all were when in the early 1990s, Jean left his position as full professor at MIT to take up a position at Toulouse. But that was the beginning of the second revolution in which Jean was a vital figure: the growth and the success of the Toulouse program in economics. And do not underestimate the fact that this was not only an intellectual enterprise, but great programs have to be financed, and we must appreciate the time and the effort in raising the funds needed to build a great program. The building of the Toulouse program has been a crucial step in the revitalization of economics all over Europe. Here at the EUI, one of the select places in Europe that competes with Toulouse in economics, we welcome the revitalization and we relish the competition, and above all, we're grateful to Jean for his role in all of this. Now, economics is a collaborative science, and in introducing a man of such immense accomplishments as Jean, it is only proper that I should make some mention of his collaborators. There are many, in a small way I'm one of them, but I would single out two: Drew Feudenberg and the late Jean-Jacques Lafon. In the early years, Drew and Jean were leaders in the application of game theory to problems in industrial organization, work that I believe was the intellectual forerunner of Jean's subsequent work on regulation. Jean-Jacques Lafon was Jean's collaborator on the key work on regulation and was a leader in the building of Toulouse. In honoring Jean, we honor also these two. Now, if I may add a personal note, in a world of aggressive and argumentative economists, Jean speaks softly and has a quiet reserve. He's a very private man, although not without a sly sense of humor, yet he's an intellectual in the best tradition of intellectuals in all disciplines and throughout the world. He thinks deeply, and if his voice is soft, He wields a mighty pen. So apparently for Jean, breadth is not the enemy of depth. And how does he do it? His friends have a theory. We believe that there's an extra time warp that contains an extra 4 hours a day. And every day, Jean steps into that time warp, he sits down at his desk, and he starts to think and to write. While the rest of us are limited to 24 hours a day, Jean has 28. Now, the rest of us have been searching far and wide for the entrance into this portal. But sadly, so far, success has eluded us. Now, here at the EY, we recognize the importance of the study of government regulation, and we have the Florence School of Regulation devoted to that purpose. So it is especially appropriate that I present Jean Tirole for admission to the honorary degree of Doctor of the European University Institute. Jean.
Mr. President, dear colleagues, dear students, by the way, congratulations for your diploma today, ladies and gentlemen. Let me convey my deep gratitude for the honor that is bestowed upon me today through the conferment of an honorary degree of the European University Institute. I feel humbled and honored by this recognition. EUI is a flagship university institution of 21 member states working toward a Europe of scholars and enjoys a great reputation. In my field, economics, EUI is a small but highly distinguished faculty, as well as, I understand, a great soccer team. I am humbled by the list of the three previous honorary doctorate in economics, Jacques Drees, Tony Atkinson, Tom Sargent, all giants of their profession. This has been a very special year for me, both wonderful and incredibly hectic. But despite all the activity, I've been very much looking forward to my visit to EUI. Incidentally, I was contacted in June 2013 by Pietro Gottardi on behalf of the Academic Council so long before the Nobel decision. But I could not come to the conferring ceremony in 2014 due to previous commitment, and EUI very generously allowed me to postpone. And indeed, it was a great privilege yesterday to give my second Max Weber lecture in 4 years with very interesting discussion following. To give the honorary degree seminar with also very interesting discussion, and of course to meet with PhD students and to see some old friends and meet new faces. It is also quite a privilege to receive the Laudatio from David Levine. David is of course an extremely distinguished scholar, worldwide known scholar, with contribution in many different fields. But also, he's a classmate of mine at MIT. We graduated together, a wonderful courser, and an old friend. For all of this, I'm very indebted and would like to convey my deep gratitude. Thank you very much. On behalf of the university, I admit you to the honorary degree of Doctor of the European University Institute.
Now time for some music. we have a musical interlude by our own EY Women's Ensemble. They're going to bring a piece of Gabriel Fauré, Messe basse pour voix de femme, Kyrie and Benedictus. It's time to award the degrees in the various disciplines. I would like to ask the historians to stand up.
Custodians of our memory, of times both good and evil, and of our rich and diverse civilization, by the authority vested in me, I admit you to the degree of Doctor of History and Civilization.
You may be seated. I call Antoine Acker. Christopher Bannister. Gabrielle Capelli. Maria Dorofeyuk. Ana Belém Fernández Castro. Alejandro García Montón. Tommaso Giordani. Ferdinand Nicolas Goede. Alexander Hugh Jordan. Karina Kalmbach. Christoph Jens Kamisek. Laura Pozzi. Mo Moritz von Brescius. James White. And Oksana Yarazhinskaya. We move to the economics. Can I please ask you to stand?
Custodians of our prosperity and commitment to a life of economic dignity for all, by the authority vested in me, I admit you to the degree of Doctor of Economics.
Silvia Albrizio. Sarah Oster. Elia Rita Faria da Costa e Silva. Moritz Helm. Irina Kirisheva. Stefan Andreas Lamp. Hans-Peter Mulgaert. Metin Nebiler. Caterina Cara Papiotti. Romanos Fritis. Jennifer Ruiz Valenzuela. Kirill Shaknov. Jan Ignacy Witajewski Baltwicz. And Czerko Zimic. We have now our second musical interlude, again from the EUI Women's Ensemble. This time they will bring a song from Gustav Holst, Two Eastern Pictures, Spring and Summer. awarding of the law PhD degrees, can I ask the lawyers to stand up, please?
Guardians of our liberties, of our commitment to a society based on justice and the rule of law, by the authority vested in me, I admit you to the degree of Doctor of Laws.
You may be seated. Chiara Altafin. Fabrizio Barzanti. Adriana Aparecida Bessa da Costa Antunes Rodriguez. Lena Boucon. Chantal Bratsky. Maria Chiara Campisi. Kiva Marie Carr. Mary Chachi. James Gerard Diveni. Mateja Jurovic. Ricardo Garcia Anton. Katarzyna Anna Granatz. Dr. Inge Harbo. Emily Hunter. Win Ching Yang Müller. Elisa Novich. Madalena Ilona Orgozalik. Fernando Pastar Merchanti. Carolina Postava. Kai Peter Purnhagen. Magdalena Schilska. Anna Södersen. Stefan Steigner Schneider. Boško Tripković. Barend Joppe van Leeuwen. Now we turn to the political and social scientists. Can I please ask you to stand up?
Guardians of our commitment to good governance and democracy, even in the most challenging of times. By the authority vested in me, I admit you to the degree of Doctor of Political and Social Sciences.
You may be seated. Amer Adli. Anna Miriam of den Brinke. Maria Birnbaum. Pietro Castelli Gattinara di Zubiela. Matteo Cernison. Donna Davis. Konstantinos Eleftheriades. Katerina Froyo. Payam Galender. Juho Petri Heikkonen. Patrick Héron. Ennio Pablo Luis Goyo. Helge Hiram Jensen. Veronika Anna Klotznovak. Vasil Kucherenko. Joana Lamotte de Grignon Perez. Emmanuel Mathieu. Lemos. Francis Patrick O'Connor. Tamara Popic. Raphael Johannes Reinke. Silvia Rossetti. Maya Spanu. Furio Stamati. Maria Concetta Tedesco. Jordanka Tomkova. Julien Topal. Milena Tripkovic. Christian Voss. And Jana Varkoč. We will award also the LLM degrees, and I would like to ask the LLM candidates to stand up.
By the authority vested in me, I admit you to the degree of Masters of Laws.
Delphine Aurélie Defossé. Pavlina Hybkova. We have some special prizes at the EUI for the best thesis, and I would like to call Professor Rainer Baubock to award these prizes.
So, after honoring all our doctorates, we still think some deserve special honors. And these are the candidates that have been awarded special prizes for the best thesis in a specific field by the respective departments. I call on the stage Sarah Oster. Elisa Novich. Marina Aksenova is the next on my list, but I think she is not here. Oh, she is. Oh, sorry. Oh, there. Okay. And Raphael Reinke. So let me just briefly say which prizes these excellent candidates have won. The first one is the Vilfredo Pareto Prize for the best thesis in economics. That's the first year ever that the economics department has decided to award a prize. And in order to make up for the many years in which they didn't, they have decided to award two prizes. So academic prizes in economics apparently are divisible goods. One goes to Sarah Oster for her dissertation on optimal contracts with non-Bayesian agents. And the second one goes to Ilse Lindenlaub, who unfortunately can't be here today. Congratulations to Sarah. The next candidate is Elisa Novich from the Law Department. She wins the Antonio Cassese Prize for the best thesis in international law for her dissertation on the concept of cultural genocide, an international law perspective. Congratulations, Elisa. We have a second prize from the Law Department, which is the Mauro Capelletti Prize for the best thesis in comparative law, and it goes to Marina Aksenova for her thesis on complicity in international criminal law. Congratulations. Last but not least, there's the Linz Rockon Prize for the best thesis in political sociology, generously sponsored by Professor Richard Rose, who also is an EUI doctor honoris causa. And this prize goes to Raphael Reinke for his thesis on the politics of bank bailouts. Congratulations, Raphael.
We have now a salute by Ricardo Garcia Anton, a recent graduate. Ricardo.
Dear members of the Academic Council, Mr. President, professors, members of the administration, colleagues, and friends. It is extraordinarily difficult to depict in words my personal experience as a PhD researcher at the European University Institute. Rather than words, I would like to talk about images. Images which grasp the succession of moments lived in this campus. Quoting Cesare Pavese, non ricordiamo mai I giorni, ma solo I momenti. We don't remember days, we remember moments. Moments such as the victory or a defeat in a match in Coppa Pavone, the encouraging talks with my supervisor, the applause of the public after performing a play, the inspiring lectures, the hours in the library, the sunset over Florence from Badia, the parties in Fiasco till morning, the encounters with old friends, the reading of poems in the garden of Skifanoia during the Festival of Arts, the infinite discussions, conversations in front of a Chianti bottle, the screening of La Dolce Vita, Nostalgia, the hugs of the friends and the motion tears of your parents after defending the thesis. Photos that will always revitalize the emotions live in this campus. A campus in which lawyers, historians, political scientists, sociologists, and economists exchange ideas and share experiences to build up a better world, a Europe of fairness and solidarity. Indeed, what I really bring back home after these years is the strong feeling of collectivity, of belonging to a group, of being loved. Although doing a PhD is by definition a solitary work, here at the European University Institute, I always felt the support, the affection of professors, administration, librarians, colleagues, and friends, the strength of the community. As Allen Ginsberg said in his well-known poem, Son, the weight of the world is love. Under the burden of solitude, under the burden of dissatisfaction, the weight we carry is love. Now, after these incredible years in Fiesole, we start a period of uncertainties, of doubts, looking for jobs, settle down in other countries, finding new friends. Il canto fu breve, una pausa, un commento improvviso e misterioso. Dino Campana wrote in Canti Orfici. But we always know that Florence and the European University Institute is our house. We will always be listening to these echoes of happiness. Adios, muchachos. Au revoir, les enfants. Thank you very much.
All good things come to an end. I want to thank you all. I want to thank again members of the High Council, my colleagues, members of the Academic Council, the teachers of our recent doctorates, our guests, families, last but not least, the new doctorates and masters. Again, congratulations to all of you. Thank you very much. I hope you enjoy the festivities. Have a wonderful weekend. Thank you. This meeting is adjourned.
There is still one thing I would like to ask you, if you could just stay in the church for 5 minutes so that the doctors can go out, have a photograph taken, and then you can go all out. Thank you.